Hey Gadget Groupies, it's time to tear into the camera on the LG V10. Now this review will be a little different than how I normally shoot. Optically, the V10 is almost identical to the G4. When it comes to video, the main differences are found in software, where the V10 has full manual controls. When shooting full auto, the output is nearly identical to the G4, so I won't be spending a lot of time showing video in auto. As a general rule, you can count on LG to overexpose almost every shot by around 2/3 of a stop, and if you're still curious what that might look like, you can see the full review on the G4 where I shoot in a number of similar situations to what I'm producing here. What I will do here though is to note in the upper left corner what settings were used to capture the footage you're looking at. Starting with some outdoor shots, the V10 is capturing a contrastier image with more vibrant colors over the G4, in part due to the fact that the V10 is saving more than twice as much information, a 64 megabit per second video file, over the G4's 30 megabit per second video. For folks who felt the G4 video was washed out or flat, the V10 takes a significant step forward in correcting that. Dialing in just a little exposure correction helps tremendously in preventing your subject from clipping in direct sunlight, like this yellow flower here. It doesn't require much adjustment, but we're better able to see the full dynamic range of what the shooter is capable of producing, and even from a medium distance, we're getting a nice soft background behind our subject. In full auto, the camera will often expose more for your entire frame than for a specific subject, and it would still be nice to have spot metering on board, but at least shifting to manual controls allows us to rein in that brightness. Blues and greens are lush and satisfying. Color in general falls a little closer to the current crop of iPhones than the more saturated look on Samsung devices. Browns are full, without the rust colors becoming too exaggerated, for example. The G4 was a champ at exposing for the color red, and the V10 follows in those footsteps. Like the iPhone, the camera is providing enough saturation for a vibrant scene, but it stopped just short of oversaturating and clipping these bougainvillea blossoms. Reds like these on Samsung phones often start to become magenta. It can't be overstated how helpful it is to be able to control the brightness while shooting video. White subjects in direct sun are very tricky to expose for properly, and one quick adjustment helps us retain a little more petal detail. The V10's focusing system feels ever so slightly slower when shooting video than when shooting stills. LG's laser focus is still second to none in providing a smooth and sure-footed focus adjustment. As the V10 is trying to court content creators, it seems they slowed the focus shift to provide more of a cinematic effect. It could be better for capturing moments between two people, for example. Still, LG continues to offer one of the best focusing systems across every lighting situation. Continuing from the G4 though, there's still the occasional tendency to report a focus lock at macro distances when the camera isn't actually focused on your subject. I focused here on the pine cone, and the phone gave me a green box confirmation, but I was actually too close, as the plane of focus is really here. Speaking of macro shots, performance is identical to the G4, which is a good thing. When you do land focus, this is one of the closer minimum focusing distances available on any phone, and the larger sensor paired with a faster aperture provides a deliciously soft bokeh. Background blur is very pleasant, like watercolor paintings, which helps draw a viewer's eye to the subject you focused on. Now, there's been some confusion regarding image stabilization on the V10. Like Samsung, this phone only uses optical image stabilization when shooting 4K video. In our walking test, we see the same wobble and sway that we saw with the G4. Also, like Samsung, we can use both optical and electronic software stabilization when shooting 1080p video, though that does crop the field of view. LG's combo stabilization is a close third, in my opinion, for smoothing out the scene behind Samsung and Apple, but depending on what kind of action you're trying to capture, it's still a marked improvement over no stabilization. There are pros and cons to be had here for sure, as I prefer a little wobble in my video so as not to lose the wider field of view like you might on the iPhone, and on stationary shots, Apple's solution can pulse in a strange way, but there is some form of stabilization used on every shot you capture with the LG V10. Into a zoom test, when pushed to its full reach, the image is pretty terrible. Blurry, washed out, we really don't have the resolution to move in this close to a subject that far away. However, dialing back the zoom about halfway, and we have a significantly better overall image. We're now only slightly behind the iPhone 6S in providing a happy compromise between image integrity and zooming in on the subject. The zoom also provides one small change from the G4 in that the V10's small ticker display becomes home to the zoom control when shooting video, giving you a fast slider to manipulate. Into a street scene, we're capturing great detail. We've got punchy, vibrant colors, great contrast, and solid dynamic range. Only white cars are barely starting to clip while we retain a pleasing blue in the sky with greens in the trees popping nicely. Freezing the scene, we see just a touch of artifacting in the uniformity of the sky, but on the whole, the V10 is noticeably outperforming the G4 when we ran it through a similar test. Our freeway scene performs similarly in terms of color, contrast, and dynamic range. We also hear some subtle improvements in audio capture over previous LGs. I still feel their noise reduction is too aggressive, and I would still put audio reproduction behind Lumias, Samsungs, and HTC, but we've certainly improved upon the underwater warbly distortion we used to hear on the LG G3. Speaking of audio, the V10 comes with the handy trick of being able to tune or focus the audio while shooting video.
Now, under normal shooting situations, this camera captures what we call figure of eight audio, where the front of the camera and the back of the camera are picking up audio in roughly the same way. But what the V10 tries to do is it allows us, through this three microphone setup and some advanced noise reduction techniques, the ability to try and focus our audio just a little bit more accurately. So with this polar pattern, I can shift it and change it and pull that audio closer to me. And this should focus more on my voice than on the phone in front of us that's playing music. Likewise, I can also push this farther away to try and pick up more of the phone and less of my voice. And both of these are helpful in different situations, where if I'm recording more my voice, it's because I really want to focus on my commentary. It'll help ignore a busy environment all around you. Or if you're at a concert and you really want to hear the music out on stage, but people around you are talking, this could be one helpful way to dial in that sound.
Getting back to our overpass, while most of my image adjustments were done via exposure compensation, users can control the brightness of a shot by dialing in ISO and shutter speed. The V10 can take you down to 1/6,000th of a second per frame. This can greatly reduce light in bright situations or give you extremely crisp action. Popping the ISO up to 200 on this shot meant I was able to freeze freeway drivers on every single frame of this 30 frame per second video with zero motion blur. Same for this stream, where every single frame is showing very crisp water spray. The 60 frame per second 1080p mode lost on the G4 finally makes a return on the V10. I can't show how smooth that video looks when this video will be rendered in 30 frames per second, but we can use this higher frame rate to produce a high quality half speed slow motion. There's also a 120 frame per second 720p slow motion video on tap. It's really difficult to see if there is any improvement here over the G4, but we can easily determine that it's quite a ways behind the fantastic slow motion mode found on the iPhone 6S. It's still fun to play with, but with so much of this camera focused on more professional controls, it's unlikely you'll be utilizing this feature very often for media creation. Onto our transition test, moving from dark to bright and back, this is one of the smoothest runs I've ever seen out of any LG product. Very subtle and pleasant transitions moving from dark to bright. Like Samsung and Apple this year, there's a bit of a stutter or shimmer moving from bright to dark again, and it's in here that LG might be tweaking the frame rate slightly. But I'm happy to say we've got a three-way race this year for automatic exposure adjustments. While there is a white balance shift moving from shadow to sun, it's not nearly as pronounced as what we saw on the iPhone, and the LG in general is handling color in shade more accurately, like this yellow lily in shadows. This feels a lot closer to the actual color of the day than the icy blue hues we received on the iPhone 6S. Speaking of white balance, it's a surprisingly helpful setting to tweak. Your camera can estimate what it thinks is accurate, but sometimes will land a bit too warm or too cool. Instead of giving us four generic presets like cloudy or tungsten light, LG gives us the same Kelvin slider they use for still photos. It's a much finer level of control to make sure we're adjusting the color to exactly where we want it. Now for some nighttime shots. The G4 had a reputation for overexposing across the board, even in lower light shots, working way harder than it needed to brighten a dark scene. The V10 does the same when shooting full auto, but now we can dial in the exposure we really want. I'm really excited to get closer to the actual mood of the environment. I can capture this street scene, retain a good amount of detail in cars driving by, and not blow out the lighting in the signs across the street. Throughout all of our low light shots, there's maybe a touch more noise than I would prefer, but if this was the choice made to prevent losing detail by applying heavy noise reduction filters, then I'll take that trade. Our creepy tunnel benefits from underexposing, bringing the lighting much closer to what it's actually like to walk that pass at night, but we're still able to catch details in the dirt above the walkway. The noise on our creepy gate scene is a bit more pronounced, and when left to automatic white balance, the camera is splitting the difference between the white color of the gate and the yellow lighting. But seeing as how I can adjust the white balance, I can show you a scene much closer to what this gate looks like in real life. Our walkway accurately showcases the differences in color temperature between these two security lights, though the bulb on the left might be just a touch warm for what these really look like in person. Into a lower light shot, these flowers lit by a yellow lamp a couple yards away, we've got good color accuracy, and we're not losing a lot of detail to noise or heavy noise reduction. Lastly, some flowers in almost total darkness. LG remains the only phone I've run through this extreme test, which was able to lock focus accurately, a situation where both Samsung and Apple both completely failed. This shot looks terrible, but it's impressive that a camera sensor this small is able to pull out any detail from the scene or is even able to focus accurately. Taking a look at some still photos, happily Samsung and LG now use a native 16:9 image sensor. So when shooting full resolution 16 megapixel stills, you don't need to crop for a widescreen shot like you do on the iPhone. I didn't discuss still photos while reviewing the G4, and here, the V10 is almost exactly the same in real-world performance. When shooting auto, you can expect consistent overexposure, but the smallest of exposure tweaks in the manual mode will rein that brightness back in. This camera produces very high-quality photos, and like we saw on video, we get pleasant color, which refrains from oversaturating reds and yellows, with very good detail and terrific depth of field blur when working at macro distances. If there's a weakness in the still photo game, it's with HDR. I find most Android phones basically treat HDR as a shadow brightening mode, which is disappointing as the camera already produces bright images on its own. Brightening the shadows means that we often lose a little contrast, which might help your subject pop out from the background. It's one of the few areas where Apple's image processing is definitely superior. Also, the image capture speed here doesn't seem to be quite as fast as Samsung's solution, and even though I tried to hold steady, there were several HDR shots in good light that had small amounts of ghosting or blur. I'm personally not a huge fan of HDR photos in general, and the controls you have to play with on the V10 just reinforce for me that manual adjustments will likely produce better images for you than automatic HDR compositing. The V10's panorama mode is solid and snappy. I find I can't pan through a scene quite as quickly as I can on the iPhone, and it takes slightly longer to process the finished image, but that lag could be a result of the sensor tracking 4 million more pixels than Apple's sensor. The photo stitching is near seamless, and it fell just behind the iPhone 6S and just ahead of the Note 5 in putting these power lines together without too much distortion. We're light years ahead of where we were last year on Android panorama pics. The hardware image stabilization on tap for low light photos is pretty remarkable. Back to those flowers and almost no light, we're able to get a surprisingly well exposed image while hand holding the phone. This wasn't locked off on a tripod, it was in my shaky hands. Holding the shutter open for 1/4 of a second, it still managed a pretty clear capture. Setting the phone up on a tripod, however, it's fantastically easy to play with long exposures, pulling off shots easily that you just can't quite duplicate on a Samsung, like this 15-second exposure over the 101 freeway. Before wrapping up, we should discuss storage. I'm very happy to see that LG is outfitting the V10 with 64 gigabytes of built-in storage and the ability to add more via micro SD card. If you're really going to promote high-quality image capture, it's difficult to trust that a phone will be able to produce a day's worth of shots without maxing out the available memory, especially if you also have all of your favorite apps, games, and some music along for the ride. When shooting 4K, you have the option to control the quality of the video up to 64 megabits per second, which is what I use throughout all of my tests. This is over twice the data rate of the G4, and file sizes similarly are more than twice as big. A single minute of 4K video here will eat up around 460 megabytes of storage. Similarly, shooting RAW photos means that the phone will save a RAW file and a finished JPEG image, the combo of both coming in around 25 megabytes. Less than 40 photos will eat up a gig of storage. The combined total of clips and photos compiled for this review topped out at over 20 gigabytes of storage. I shot a similar amount of footage on the 16 gigabyte iPhone, and it's no surprise that I had to offload data twice to finish that review. But even looking at the 32 gigabyte options from Samsung, I'd be dangerously close to maxing out the built-in storage available to the user on a Note 5 or S6 Edge Plus. The LG V10 afforded me plenty of room to complete this review without having to manage data on the device. And at any time I might have gotten close to maxing this phone out, storage salvation was only a memory card away. So where's that leave us with the camera on the LG V10? This thing is a beast. I'm really fond of LG's strategy with this phone in general, providing more features and a bit more style without losing anything we liked about older phones. The immediate comparison with the G4, everything I liked about that camera is still here, and they've fixed almost everything I criticized about the G4's camera experience. It trades blows against the current Galaxy lineup of phones, but ultimately becomes the more desirable offering when you see how feature-complete the manual modes are. Samsung's Pro Mode is good, but LG's is on a whole nother level. Opposite devices like the iPhone 6S, the V10 stumbles more on fun features like slow motion and HDR, but the sensor lens combination is a solid generation ahead of Apple's Shooter. And LG's camera app is better refined now, offering satisfying experiences for the most novice shooter to the most demanding content creator. Weighing all the pros and cons, benefits and compromises, I'm not conflicted in the slightest, declaring the LG V10 as the best smartphone camera on the market. Well, at least for today, anyway. As always, thanks so much for watching. Be sure to subscribe for more in-depth reviews like these, and I would not be able to continue producing on this channel if you all weren't out there supporting it by hitting the fan funding, shopping for a loot crate, or grabbing a free audiobook using the links below this video, or by sharing my reviews on your favorite social sites like Facebook, Twitter, Google+, and the Reddit. So please keep bringing more cool people to the party. Hit that thumbs up button, and I will catch you all on the next review.